Yo, what up, Facebook? It's Derek and Dan here back for another episode of D&D Sports Chat. We'll be going live here in just a momento. Stay tuned. Episode 29.
Wow.
One away from 30.
Almost 30.
Yes. All right, we about ready to go live here?
Talk Show. Recorded live.
Well, good evening, everybody, and welcome to episode number 29 of D&D Sports Chat, coming to you live from the studio here in Garden City, Michigan. It is Wednesday, September the 7th, 2016. I'm your host, Derek, as always my co-host every week, Mr. Dan Bartley. Dan, what's going on, my man?
Ah, it's a beautiful day in Michigan. Nice, droopy, rainy day.
Do you notice something? That looking out the window, it's already dark out?
It's
or
dark.
Getting there?
It is.
Is it starting to get darker? Fall back, as we should say. Spring forward, fall
losing
back.
Losing sleep shortly enough.
Yeah, one more month. I think we're going to be losing sleep again. So, actually, no. Fall back, we gain an hour of sleep.
Oh, yeah.
So we're going to gain that hour of sleep. Just as we lost it back in, what was it, April? We're going to be gaining that hour back here in about a month or so. So, yeah, I looked outside because normally it doesn't get dark until a little after 9. So seeing this is like, oh, crap. But it is a little overcast. We got some rain today, a lot of rain, as a matter of fact.
Yeah, downpour for a little while.
There was actually a severe thunderstorm warning for Wayne County about an hour or so ago. So
sure,
got pretty nasty, but
Doppler
it was much.
Doppler Tom was all over that.
Yes, yeah, shout out to Doppler Tom. I'm sure he was right on top of that. But it cleared out pretty quickly, and now clear skies. So anyways, how are we doing tonight?
Pretty good.
Doing all right?
Yeah, can't complain.
My dad, host of GC Community Chat, wanted me and Danny both to give a few shout-outs here. There's three local events before we talk sports. We wanted to just give a quick update. Dan, you got one of them for us?
I sure do. Saturday, September 17, 2016, from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m., Garden City gives a boot. Donate new and gently used boots. Men's and women's are accepted at the Lucky Squirrel event in Garden City Farmers Market Lot, northeast corner of Middlebelt and Ford. So give a hand to the homeless vets. Questions?
Absolutely.
Contact Kelly Bailey at 734-837-7940. Give a boot, Garden City. Give a boot.
Give a boot. And as well as that, we have coming up here in just a few weeks, actually 1 month almost from tomorrow, is the Chili Cook-Off Afterburn, which is going to be happening immediately after the Chili Cook-Off. Come to the Afterburn on Saturday, October 8th from 5 p.m. to 9 p.m. It's immediately, as I said, following the Chili Cook-Off, featuring Bonnie and the Working Girls. It will be sponsored by the Garden City Business Alliance. Just go to www.gardencitybusinessalliance.org for more information. Looking forward to that. I will be at the Chili Cook-Off, tasting some really, really good chili, and there'll be a lot of entertainment. And I believe that they'll also have a fire. The fire station has their open house as well. So real big family event. So definitely come check that out if you're able to. Also, this is a big one. The second annual, sponsored by the Garden City Business Alliance and the Downtown Development Authority, the Trunk or Treat. Second annual Spooktacular Trunk or Treat, Thursday, October 27th from 5:30 p.m. until 7 p.m. in the Kroger Plaza parking lot, which is also the farmer's market. That's north of Ford Road and east of Middlebelt. Donations of non-perishable food items for our Garden City Food Bank will be gladly accepted and collected at the event. Volunteers are still needed. Please email Elaine Salter at esalter1125@yahoo.com to participate or donate candy or contact the DDA at 734-261-2830. That's also going to be an awesome event. The event was just posted on Facebook about a week ago, and already there's over 1,000 people that are interested in going. So this drew, I think, like 3,000 people or more last year. So huge, huge event. I think it's going to probably top that. And I was a part of that, and I'll be there again this year passing candy for Gordon. So three awesome events. So
that
come
is
and check
really
those
neat,
out.
Passing out candy. I know Halloween is as much as we love it.
It's my favorite month.
And we absolutely love it.
Yes.
We adore it. But it's kind of lost its edge a little bit with all the creeps out there.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, kids aren't going trick-or-treating.
Poison
candy.
This is one way that
you can still do it.
In a safe environment.
And it's actually more convenient, you know.
It is.
Do all the walking, which...
Because you got to figure, I mean, I think last year they had like over 50 cars mm-hmm. or vehicles that participated. You just decorate your trunk and pass out candy. And, I mean, you just form a line. I mean, my God. I think it actually went over like by a half hour. So, I mean, I remember being there. It was cold. It was a cold night. I don't remember a night in October being that cold. I think it was like almost 30 degrees for October. So definitely it was a very, very busy, chilly, but fun event. And it brought out a lot of different cities. It wasn't just Garden City. It was Westland, Livonia, Canton. People from Ohio came down.
Wow. Nice.
Or came up, I should say. But yeah, like all sorts of different communities and counties came out, and thousands of kids came in good costumes and just an overall fun, family-oriented event.
Get ready for the Harley Quinn Joker.
Oh yeah, you'll see. Yep, yep. Like little kids even that don't
little
even know what that is.
Harley Quinn.
Yep, that's gonna be the popular costume. I remember back a few years ago, Joker and Bane was a big costume. I feel like whenever any Batman movie comes up, the main characters are always gonna be a popular commodity for Halloween. So look out for the Harley Quinns this year.
Look out for those Harley Quinns.
Before we talk sports tonight, we obviously, our odd story of the week. It's sometimes odd, sometimes funny, sometimes entertaining, sometimes not even that so odd. But tonight, actually earlier today, it all started. Dan was sending me a text message about Goosebumps on Netflix. And he said something like, yeah, you know, I noticed that the Goosebumps is all the episodes are on Netflix and we should like watch them and just kind of relive our childhood. And I said, you know what? Screw it. Why the hell not? You know what I mean? So tonight, after the show, back in my crib, we're actually going to have a little Goosebumps viewing party, whatever you want to call it. You know, so I haven't seen a Goosebumps episode in years.
I couldn't tell you.
You haven't watched any of these? You just happen to see
them? No, I happen to be browsing through and found it. But the last Goosebumps I've seen was the actual movie with Jack Black.
I never saw that. I heard it was good. I heard it was good.
It was okay.
I've heard different reviews, but mostly good.
Which is also on Netflix, by the way.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. I might watch it, but to me, the movie, if only they could have taken Goosebumps and just made it more of an adult. Like, we know that it's based off of a kid's book, and we know that the author
Earl Stein.
But to make it a little bit more gory?
You can't do that.
I know. But what a twist it would have been, though, to turn, like, a kid's book into, like, a more adult movie. And that would have been really, really cool. I would have saw it.
Goosebumps Grown Up.
Yeah, Goosebumps Grown Up, whatever. But, yeah, I mean, I listed my favorites, Haunted Mask, Terror Towers, Stay Out of the Basement. Those were my top three. I owned those all on VHS tapes back in the day. They're probably somewhere out in the garage in boxes collecting dust. But those were the good old days. So that should be fun later on tonight. Way to stay up late and not get no sleep for work tomorrow. Screw it. Who needs sleep, right? Anyways, so to dive into sports, the Tigers, they played today, and they dropped the series 2-3 against Chicago. And this was a series that, in my opinion, the Tigers needed to win. You know, they've got to beat the teams that they are supposed to beat, Minnesota, Chicago being those two teams. And they've not been able to take care of they did win the overall season series. I think it was like 12-7. But at this point of the season, you need to be on – all cylinders, and as of right now, Justin Upton seems to be the only guy firing on all those cylinders, and the bullpen continues to be our weakness. So,
what can you do?
No, you can't.
September's here.
The call-ups have all begun. We got
Menez
Moya
is still down.
Yeah, they're not bringing up Jimenez. I've heard that he's staying in AAA. He needs more conditioning as well.
Well, the Mudhen season's over.
Yeah, what
coming up in the next couple of days? Lloyd McLennan's even coming up here.
Yeah, to give a little bit of added insight. And, you know, obviously it's just – I don't know what has to be done. But all I know is that this bullpen needs to figure their shit out. And now with Jordan Zimmermann coming off the DL, he's going to be thrown back in, I think. Is he actually going to be in the starting rotation or is he going to the bullpen?
He starts on Saturday.
Okay. So, you know, you got your best pitching going. You got Verlander. You got Fulmer on Friday. You get a day off tomorrow, much needed, and then you got to gear up against a huge 3-game series against Baltimore, and you got three
top tier
pitchers.
You have your three best pitchers going, so you should take 2 or 3.
Zimmermann worries me because even when he was slightly healthy towards that stretch, he was really tailing off, and I don't know what was the deal there, but he was not throwing blanks in AAA. He was definitely struggling, but he claims he's healthy. He feels good. He's seeing the ball, or he's throwing the ball at his velocity that he feels comfortable with. And, you know, I guess all there is to do now is wait and see what happens on Sunday.
With Zimmerman, it's Saturday. But with Zimmerman, I think it's mechanics, follow through, being able to repeat his delivery, making sure that he has his good stuff.
Right.
Obviously, coming back, he's going to be relatively fresh. He hasn't pitched a whole lot of innings this season. So that might pay dividends if the Tigers do make a playoff push. Which, with Michael Fulmer, you're concerned. The Tigers are concerned by his innings limit. You're going to be questioning that all season long, what to do with Zimmerman. Mike Pelfrey's going to the bullpen. So that's whatever with Mike Pelfrey.
I like it because we've seen a lot of very, very good quality starts out of Matt Boyd and Daniel Norris both. They've kind of really surprised a lot of people. And they're doing the thing. As a fourth and fifth starter, they're doing what they have to do. What about Sanchez? What do you see him now with Zimmerman back? Is he going to go back to the bullpen? Since you got Norris and Boyd up here?
Man.
He was shining in the bullpen.
That's a tough one.
That was where I feel like that's where Sanchi got his mojo back, is when he went to the bullpen. And then when they called him up, it took him a few starts to kind of get his stride back. But, I mean, he did okay today. He went 5, gave up 3, struck out 2, walked 1. So he didn't have a lights-out performance, but it wasn't a terrible performance. He did what he had to do. He's right now currently a fourth, fifth starter. So he's doing what he had to do. And our offense, other than, you know, Justin Upton, did not perform today. And thank God he's starting to find – he's found his bat swing, as we've noted
his
before.
His bat swing,
whatever you want to call it. He's kind of getting back in that groove. He's finding his potential of what
he is. Brett Ausmus, much as we've dogged him and everybody's dogged him in Detroit, I'll give him his props on this one. Sitting down Justin Upton for those 3 days –
did something.
Was a great decision. Brett Ausmus has made several decisions and many decisions throughout the pitching staff, throughout the bullpen.
That is
very up in the air. But with this decision with Upton, he looks like an absolute genius. And I'm never going to probably ever say that with Brett Ausmus ever again. But you got to give the guy his due.
And not only that, but he says his secret has been skipping batting practice. He's not been taking batting practice. He's not messing up whatever kind of mojo or whatever his swing is right now. So whatever works,
he's carrying the
roll with it.
Ball. His home runs are not cheapies.
No, they're not. They are like 400 plus foot. Yes, they are line drives. They are moonshots. And he's found something. And, you know,
confidence is big.
And, you know, I guess you can dog them for the first half, but they all say the second half is what matters. It's how you finish, not how you start. So,
Victor Martinez did get hurt in today's game.
He did sliding. He was aggressive. I wish he would have done that.
Victor Martinez running for that double.
He should have stayed at first. He had no chance of getting that double. And honestly, I mean, I hope it doesn't really hurt us in the long haul. I'm sure he'll probably be out a couple games. He looked in severe pain.
It's worrisome.
Those leg ankle
Ian
problems. Kinsler's
not at 100%. Miguel Cabrera, you don't know about as well.
Miguel Cabrera, though, I mean, he's already hit 31 home runs. He's gonna hit 100 RBIs again, and he might not be in the MVP voting right now for the AL. I think he's a little bit behind in, you know, RBIs, but definitely has been the shining spot in the second half for the Tigers, along with Justin Upton. And I think Ian Kinsler, for that brief moment, was also kind of getting back into where he was finding his strides, but now he's kind of struggling again. So JD has also kind of been iffy the past few games, but overall, since his return, I'm not worried about JD. He'll bounce back.
JD is. Tigers have a very good lineup of guys.
We got five guys on this team that
really
have 20 or more home runs.
One through five, one through six is really, really dynamite for the Tigers right now. You know, even Jose Iglesias, the guy doesn't have a whole lot of pop in his bat, but he's going to make contact. He's not going to strike out.
And his defense speaks for itself, too. Mm-hmm. So, and also, you know, I really like having Casey McGeehee back here, because I feel like that's going to, I think, pay dividends as well as we get closer to the stretch.
Defensively, not so much.
No, defensively, you know, we'll see. But offensively, he'll have that hit every now and then. Kind of like Assal Palamacchia. He had a solid hit the other game. I mean, you're not going to depend on him. But in a pinch, maybe.
I could care less if Casey McGeehee was ever a Tiger again. I'll go that far with the fact that Jacoby Jones needs to play.
He does. I mean, obviously he has.
Whether if it's center field or third base, but that is the problem right now. Jones, he had that one bad game, and then boom, he's sitting.
You can't do that.
Casey McGeehee is up here for that veteran leadership guy that can come in there, and he's not going to hit you a whole lot of dingers. He's not going to do a whole lot offensively. He's a very steady third baseman, but I would rather get the kid in there, Jones.
Yeah.
I don't know why you're putting.
He can play
McGeehee
under pressure. He's proven that he can play under pressure. He doesn't get rattled easily. Yeah, he had that one game he went 0-4, had a couple strikeouts. So what? You know, you got to get the jitters out of the way first. You're not going to hit perfectly. I mean, you're not a superstar yet, but he's been able to come in some clutch moments in his very, very, very short major league career and deliver for you. So,
Casey McGee, you know what he's going to do. Mm-hmm. The back of his baseball card states what he's going to do. He's been in the league for several seasons. His best years were with the Milwaukee Brewers in 2009, 2010. But his time is gone. He's in his mid-30s. He's not going to do up a whole here lot for offensively.
He's up here for mentoring purposes, really.
He's up here talent. Just basically because the Tigers don't have another option at third base.
Right.
Besides, you know, and Jones, I think, is more comfortable in the outfield. And obviously with Cameron Maben ailing, I think that he's still in a lot of pain. I think he said it himself that he's not 100%. So
I can exactly rub some dirt in it, you know, for Cameron
Maben.
That's
not Cameron Maben. Cameron Maben is as great of a season that he had. That is overshadowed by the fact of his injuries and how long. And he can't stay in the lineup. Cameron Maben's been a great addition to this ball club, no questions.
Right, right.
But the problem that I have with Cameron Maben is he seems to be just injury prone, and
he's a prissy. He really is.
A little bit of a nagging injury issue.
Yes.
It's a little bit of a concern for me going forward with Cameron Maben. I don't know if that was his issues with other ball clubs, but it seems like the injury bug hits him, and it just something that seems to be minor takes him out for weeks.
Mm-hmm.
Ian Kinsler, kind of maybe the same injury, thumb injury, finger injury, whatever it might be.
Right.
He's back in there a day or two later.
Yeah.
It's the mental toughness. It is a grind playing professional baseball. I'm not going to say it's not. Guys are going to get hurt. You're going to need a day off from time to time. But for me, for Cameron Maben, it's just as good as he's been, I think it could be even better.
Oh, I agree.
Without the injuries, maybe I'm a little bit tough on my guys because I know Cameron Maben is the straw that stirs that drink for the Tigers.
Right.
And without Cameron Maben, you can see the top of the lineup struggles. I think Cameron Maben is definitely that guy that sets the table for the big boys in the lineup. He's got to get on base. He's got to steal some bags. And obviously, he might need that big oven mitt that Rajay Davis had when he was a Tiger.
Let's talk about the bullpen because we can't just keep dodging.
We
can't keep dodging the obvious, and we can't keep sugarcoating what we have. Obviously, we addressed Sanchez, had a decent game. Rondon, I feel like, is going to be an important part on the back end of this. And turning games into meaningful closing games, because I feel like Rondon is starting to find something again. I've liked what I've seen. And also Alex Wilson continues to pitch good. But today it was the story of Shane Green and Justin Wilson. The continued struggles of Justin Wilson put in full effect. But Shane Green blowing today's save, a very, very important blown save. And honestly, I mean, it worries me. His last seven games, he has an ERA north of 11. And, I mean, I don't really know where this is coming from. This is coming from a guy that just, you know, a couple weeks ago was a guy you could rely on at the back end of the bullpen.
Well, remember, I don't know if you recall this number. He does have a groin issue. He did have a little bit of a nagging injury.
Yeah.
You don't know how much that is affecting him, if it's still hurting him or not.
If you're not up to your 100% par, then you might as well get out of the lineup. We got other guys that can definitely take his spot.
Shane Green's been good. To his credit.
Yeah.
Yes, he's been a starter in the past, but you move him to the bullpen, and he's had a fairly good season.
Yeah.
Now, you mentioned Bruce Rondon. Now, Bruce Rondon reminds me a lot of Fernando Rodney. Got great stuff.
Yes.
Fernando Rodney had a great changeup, which Rod Allen called the Bugs Bunny changeup, I do recall.
Yeah.
With Rondon, it's gas. He's going to blow you away, or he's going to walk you. Or he's going to give up monster hits.
Because he can be erratic, and he pitches to contact. I mean, he can strike you out, but at the same time,
I'm throwing high 90s, 97, 98 mile an hour fastballs, should be missing some bats.
Because
if he does connect with one of those bad boys, it's going to go a long way.
Well, look what Justin Verlander has done. The most home runs he's given up in his entire career in one season. I mean,
he's up for a Cy Young award.
Yeah, he's still up for Cy Young. I feel like that might hurt him. But Bruce Rondon, you can't argue the stats. I mean, obviously, his last 15 games, 2-0, 1.26 ERA with 20 strikeouts. So he's definitely found something. We were really ragging on Rondon about a month ago, but just like Justin Upton, I feel like he's finding something in his pitches. But Shane Green and Justin Wilson definitely going in the opposite, especially Justin Wilson going totally south. He was a guy just like his counterpart, Wilson. He was a guy that you could actually depend on in, you know, set up roles or going, you know, long relief innings. But he's lost something. I really don't know what it is, but Justin Wilson worries
me. A little
bit
of a funk right now.
He is. It's a big time funk. Mm-hmm. It's been going on for about a week now. And when he comes into games, this is it makes you cringe. And this is another
K-Rod's
one.
K-Rod's passing guys left and right on the save.
Yes.
But K-Rod's been good.
K-Rod did give up a run the other day, but
he needs to have
I feel
a day
like,
or two of rest because he's been pitching a lot of baseball.
Well, and then maybe that has something to do with the reason why he has seemed so hittable since the All-Star break. He's another guy that he's not falling completely apart like, you know, say, you know, any other closer that in Detroit's Tigers history that has always seemed to blow it in the second half of the season. But his stuff has definitely seemed a little bit more hittable. And, you know, I don't know if he's just kind of having trouble finding his pitches or his velocity might be a little bit down, but you know, K-Rod, he's not really up to par with what he was before the All-Star break.
He's basically a one-pitch pitcher.
Yes.
He has basically one or two pitches that he throws up there, and you hit it or you don't.
Mostly fastballs.
He doesn't have a whole lot of pitches now in his arsenal.
Yeah.
He's kind of at the tailspin of his career.
Yeah. A couple
still,
more years
still
left.
Still has a couple more years left in him. You're hoping that he is successful, and you're hoping. But all honesty, with this Tigers organization in recent years, Francisco Rodriguez has been the best closer in, I think, 5 or 6 years.
Yeah. I mean, arguably, obviously, next to that Papa Grande year that he
that
had.
That was just an
then
absolute
he went, what,
fluke.
39 of 39 saves, I believe it was.
It was an absolute fluke.
It was a fluke, definitely, because the following year he was just awful. But, you know, obviously going into this year, he lived up to the expectations. The contract, $7.5 million, was just about what he's been worth this year. I'm not dogging it. 3-3, 2.81 ERA, and he's only blown 4 saves. He's got 39 this year. He's only one away from 40. And
there's only a few guys
that's great.
That I can think of at the top of my head that I would, for the money that you're going to give a closer, a guy that comes in the ninth inning that has to have a quick memory and that ice water in his veins type mentality, there's only a few guys I could want over Francisco Rodriguez right now.
Mm-hmm.
I can put it that way.
And he's been the big dance. He's been in these pressure situations, and he's even spoken recently about how he wants to end his career on a high note. He wants to win another World Series championship. Not saying he has a great chance of doing it this year with the Tigers, but, I mean, at the same token, he's with a contender that could flukishly make it there and could go all the way. I mean, any team in the postseason could go all the way, but he definitely wants to go on top, and he's doing a lot of mentoring, too. You got a young bullpen. You have a veteran like this guy that's been in the league, won a World Series with the Angels. He's been there before, so he's the right mentor for the job, and I think that it's going to take some time. I mean, obviously, you're not going to turn around a young bullpen overnight, but I think Frankie's that right guy to do it.
So, talking about the bullpen, and I know I brought this up, but why is Mark Lowe, why is Mike Pelfrey going to be in this bullpen shortly?
Yes.
But Jimenez, a guy that's been sensational all season long, yes, it's been in Double A, yes, it's been in Triple A, why are you not giving this guy an opportunity?
You got a guy like,
until at least the end
Mark
of the season.
Mark Lowe with an ERA of over 8, and you
I would love to know why, and I haven't read or heard anything as to why Jimenez is not here.
All I heard was I did see something when I noticed that Jimenez was not on the September call-up list. I heard that he needs some more fine-tuning. I mean, I don't know what more fine-tuning you can have. The AAA Mudhen season's over. It's going to be over here very, very shortly.
Mudhens are
right
not
here,
very
right
good.
Here. From the Detroit News, this was posted 2 days ago. This is the exact same article I read. Lynn Henning put,
oh, gosh.
I don't know how, I mean, you're more inept with, you know, these articles and these, you know, bloggers or publicists, whatever you want to call them, but, let's see. So, Joe Jimenez simply is yet too green for the Tigers' eyes, no matter that
too
his
green.
No matter that his 2016 numbers have been furious. A 1.54 ERA and a .80 WHIP in 54 games, with only 25 hits allowed in 54 innings, spiced with 78 strikeouts and only 15 unintentional walks.
Oh, that's too good for Detroit.
Jimenez will wrap up his 2016 campaign this week at AAA Toledo and take a long off-season rest, interrupted only by the September 18th, 15th instructional camp at Tigers minor league headquarters in Lakeland. The issue in not bringing him to Detroit is simple. His secondary pitches don't yet match his high 90s fastball and putting away hitters. He's like a lot of younger pitchers that have real good fastballs. This is according to Dave Littlefield, who is the Tigers vice president of player development. He's been able to use his fastball a majority of the time to get his outs, and in Joe's case to dominate, but we think getting him some additional work focusing on secondary pitches will be the key to his success.
All right, I'm not going to call nobody out here, but then again, I am right now, because that's bullshit. One, You gotta,
he won't make you worse.
You got to give this guy an opportunity because what he's done, you got to say, okay, we're going to give you the rest of this season. Mark Lowe sure has a great secondary pitch, right? Mark Lowe's been striking guys out left and right because you know that experiment's worked so well. So clearly the Tigers brass did a great job in acquiring Lowe. He's been great. So
bust.
He's a young guy.
Yeah.
But in order for him to develop, you got to throw him into the fire.
Tell me how different it was to bring Michael Fulmer up here, and you ran with him, and you really didn't have high expectations for a guy like Michael Fulmer.
And here's the thing about Michael Fulmer. He doesn't have great secondary pitches either.
No, he doesn't. But nobody's been able to really figure him out to the ability to
and his mechanics are not exactly flawless.
But they're going to get better.
If you watch Michael Fulmer, his mechanics scare the crap out of you because it's not fluid.
No.
It's not real easy motion.
No, it's not graceful pitching.
It's not. But he's dominating.
Mm-hmm.
As far as we can tell.
Dominating meaning he's not been lit up. He's given up 4 runs. That's not bad for a rookie. I mean, he's not been lit up for 7-8 runs in a game.
This little field guy, yes, he knows a lot more than we do.
He's like he's protecting.
I'm not going to try to say that I know more than he does because I'm not going to go there. But here's the thing. You got to give Jimenez an opportunity to pitch in the bigs. He's not going to be on your playoff roster if the Tigers do clinch a playoff berth.
Yes.
Give him an opportunity. The rosters are expanded. You don't have to put him in high leverage situations. You don't have to bring him in when the Tigers are winning by 1 or 2 runs. You can bring him in on blowouts. You can bring him in when the Tigers are getting spanked. Whatever. You give this
prove
kid
him.
An opportunity.
Yeah, prove his point.
You throw him into the fire. Give him an opportunity of what the pennant chase is like. Get him a taste, a cup of coffee, whatever it might be in the big leagues. But you give this guy an opportunity and you say, thank you for a good season. Have a great year. Try to make the team out of next year's camp. But no. You want to say it because he doesn't have good secondary pitches, but that this Tigers bullpen is just going to be the Achilles heel of this team. So Dave Littlefield, that's for you. Or whatever his name. Litchfield, whatever.
Littlefield.
Littlefield. Little dumbass.
Littlefield.
I don't get it. I have a hard time. The secondary pitches, until you see what he does here with his secondary pitches, what major league hitters are able to do to him, if they're able to knock him around with his secondary pitches, then okay, fine. Then you're right. But until that's been proven, give him a couple games. Let him appear in some games. Get his feet wet. Get him comfortable. See what he can do. Yes, everybody's going to expect the world because everybody's reading the dirt sheets.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody's reading what he's doing in the minors and saying, oh, yeah, he's the next blah, 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 blah. So there you have it. He's going to have a lot of pressure on him, but bring him up.
This is the perfect time to do it because you're going to have games along the way. We still got a little less than a month of baseball left, and you're going to have games where you're either going to be winning by a blowout or you're going to get blowed out, and that would be perfect.
You throw him in there and you say try to get some outs.
Yes. Show off what you have. There's no pressure. There's no pressure when you have a 5-run lead. There's no pressure when you have when you're losing by 5 or 6 runs. You just go out there and be yourself.
You have that really good fastball. Okay, as long as you're hitting your spots. As reliever, I think you can get through some guys.
Yeah.
I think one
inning.
You can miss a few
need.
Bats.
Yeah.
Joel Zamaya missed some bats.
I feel like he would be the perfect guy to follow up a guy like a Boyd or a Norris or a Sanchez. I feel like having, because those guys usually can only go 5 or 6 innings, so have him come in the 6th inning.
Depending on the situation.
In the situation, absolutely.
Depending on what's going on with the game at hand.
Right.
Is what. When you bring him in. But obviously, we don't have to worry about that because the Tigers brass.
Yeah. He was one of the names a couple weeks ago when we were talking about September call-ups. He was one of the names I think we both agreed on that was going to be up here. We said Moya. We said Jimenez. We said McGehee would be back up here. You know, so, I mean, it's unfortunate that we're not going to get to see Jimenez this year. But like I said, he wouldn't have hurt our team, but he could have slightly improved it.
That's a tough pill for me to swallow.
Mm-hmm.
Knowing that
that potential is going to be sitting in the offseason.
The excuse was his secondary pitches.
Yeah.
Now, I can't live with that because I haven't seen him get lit up with his secondary pitches yet.
Why don't you have a chance, instead of like us proving you wrong, Littlefield, why don't you give us a chance so that, you know.
Let him
we
come
can
up here and let him
let him
throw his secondary pitches and let him get rocked.
Then you say, okay, thank you. Let
we
us have a chance to prove you wrong instead of, you know, you being proved right. So.
And the other token, this is a playoff pennant chase.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're getting... If you're bringing a rookie in, can you live with Jimenez getting lit up? Can you live with that?
Right.
In a pennant chase, you got a rookie that costs you your playoff berth, potentially one game. But again, that's why you don't bring him in these big pressure situations. Problem solved. Call him up. Mistake.
And, you know, that's been the plague. And it's just the way I look at it is like, how can you get any worse with this bullpen? I mean, we probably have like one of the low bottom 10 bullpens in all of baseball. I mean, the fact that we're still over 500 has nothing to do with that bullpen. Trust me. But
Frankie Rodriguez has been good. But
yeah, Frankie. Not, yeah,
Frankie Rodriguez.
I feel like Frankie Rodriguez and Alex Wilson have probably been the two brightest spots of our bullpen. Mm-hmm. And those are guys that I could rely on. But other than that, I mean, who's our setup man been? Justin Wilson? That's our setup man for the most part. Kyle Ryan?
Mark Lowe is supposed to be your setup man, too.
Showed some spots earlier in the season where he could be like, not bad, but even he sinked. And, you know, I mean, if Justin Wilson can get his stuff back, I feel like he can be dangerous again. But right now, Mark Lowe, Kyle Ryan, see ya. Couldn't have made anybody worse. But yeah, like I said though, tune in this weekend. They have an off day tomorrow and then a big series against Baltimore. And
should be some good baseball.
To me, and I said this to Steve today because I was so freaking fed up with this loss. You lose 2-3 to Baltimore. Is it safe to say that you're pretty much out of the playoff race? Is it still too early to tell?
No. Nope.
All right. Can we agree that if you drop 2 out of 3 against Baltimore, you're out of the division race? You're already right now. You're 5.
You want to make
if
sure
if Cleveland wins tonight, they go to 5.5.
If you get swept in Baltimore, you're done.
Yeah, because Cleveland,
you got to win. You got to win at least one. Chris Tillman's not pitching.
I won't be happy with that. I really want him to take 2 out of 3.
The biggest concern for the Tigers going forward is you need to make sure that you have a lead going into the 7th, 8th, 9th inning.
Mm-hmm.
Because that bullpen is.
Tillman and
Darren O'Day lights out. Zach Britton lights out. Forget it.
Yep. And you got to contain Machado.
Machado, Jones. Their offense is just potent.
Yep. Crush Davis.
Yeah.
You know,
he got hurt though. He's a little bit hurt right now.
Is he
banged up?
This was actually a 4-game series right now. Cleveland has dropped, and this is what I'm talking about. Prime opportunity. As I take off the mic. Hope I didn't damage anything there. But this is prime opportunity. Cleveland they've dropped 2 straight to the Astros, and the Astros are right on our asses now for the wild card spot. They're actually only a half game behind us. And that game right now is currently, look at this, bottom of the 4th inning, Cleveland's losing 3-2. So Cleveland could drop 3 in a row to the Astros, and we had a chance to gain 2 games. We could have been 2.5 games once again instead of being 4.
Remember, you are going to see Cleveland very, very
seven
soon
times.
For that pivotal 7-game stretch.
Well, there's going to be we got a 3-game set in Cleveland, and then the very final home game series will be the 4-game series, which, in my opinion, if you are still within 4 to 5 games of Cleveland when you enter that final 4-game series, you have a chance, but you have to take 3 out of 4 basically, and then you got one more road series. So. You cannot be when you come back home to face Cleveland in a couple weeks for that long 4-game series. You have to be within 4.5 games, 4 games to me, to in order to have a chance. But I don't know if that's going to be the case. But you have to start off now, and you have to take 2 out of 3 against Baltimore this weekend. You're at home, where you've been playing good.
You need to.
You got your 3 best pitchers, 2 for sure going, and. I mean, those 2 pitchers, if you get the run support, should get you the win. So there should be no excuses.
It's going to be a really tight leash with the 100 pitches for Jordan Zim in his first start.
And Michael Fulmer. I feel like Michael Fulmer, they've been really dependent. And like we've been seeing this for weeks, is that you got to watch his inning count. You got to watch his pitches. I don't think you really want to keep that leash too long with Michael Fulmer this start coming up.
He's approaching. He's right where he's. Mm-hmm. He hasn't pitched as many.
I really don't want to see him go beyond the 6th inning. I feel like you have to. Even if he's only given up 1 run or even no runs, I feel like you got to cut him right around that 95 pitch plateau. 6 innings, I feel like Michael Fulmer could probably go maybe 7 if you want to inch him towards the 7th inning, but. You can't press him too much. I feel like that's why he's been getting in his last 2 starts. He's gotten 2 losses. He hasn't had a win in over a month.
Here's what I'm going to test his recent struggles to. Brett Ausmus and the Tigers staff, because you can't have a guy that's going every 5 days, and then you're going to rest him for 8, and then you're going to rest him again for 7. So, baseball players, especially pitchers, they're in a routine.
Mm-hmm. You're messing that up.
You're after you start. You go ice your arm. The next day after, you relax. You don't do nothing. The second day, you start doing light stretching. The third day, you start running. You start stretching your arm. The fourth day, you throw a ball.
But then you add 3 extra days off to that.
But then you add extra time.
Yes.
It gets you in a funk. It gets you out of that routine that you're in. So that's what ruined Michael Fulmer, is that you're tweaking. You're making all, we're going to give him 8 days off, nine days off.
The mojo's all messed up.
You're going to skip his starts. I think that does more harm than good sometimes. To a guy like Michael Fulmer, you have a rhythm. Yeah. You have that certain, you know what you're going to do the next day after your start, and the second day and third day. And you're going to get ready for that start. You're going to mentally prepare. You're going to look at what team you're facing. You're going to go over scouting reports. With Fulmer is he's got 8 days, so he's going, oh, I think I'm going against Baltimore. So you don't really know.
It's a little bit of a head stress.
So I think that is a head scratcher for me.
Yes.
With the Tigers skipping his starts, and I know you want to kind of watch his innings, but that also can hurt you because you're getting a young guy out of his rhythm and maybe in a potential funk. So if you're going to point the finger at anybody, blame the Tigers organization. Blame Osmus, whoever made that decision to skip his start, to rest him 7 or 8 days. Because pitchers are very in their routines. And I think when you break these routines, I am a firm believer in this, that it just sets everything back and then you struggle.
His last win came on August the 14th at Texas. And since then, he has actually lost his last three starts. But I mean, you know, he did have his worst outing that he had was that six. He did give up six. I do take that back. I thought it was four, but he did give up six earned in that thrashing against Boston. That was his worst start of his career, short career. But I mean, since then, he's given up three runs in all three starts. He went five on August the 27th against LA. He went six innings. Let's see here. He went six innings against KC. I'm sorry, I was looking at three. So he's lost his last two, not three. But he actually, yes, at KC, he actually went six innings, gave up three.
I'm concerned about his start against Baltimore.
Yeah. Well, it's not going to be a cakewalk. He really needs that, but he's not had the run support. You know,
no run support.
When you go,
he's also been going against a lot of pitchers.
When you go six and seven innings and you only give up three earned runs, that can get you a win. I mean, you can still have your offense.
Here's the problem holes four and five, for the next series against Baltimore. Fulmer versus Guzman.
Mm-hmm.
Miley versus Zimmerman.
That's going to be up in the air.
Ubaldo Jimenez versus Justin Verlander.
And that should be a W. That finale should be a W. There should be no excuses why he can't beat and hit off of Ubaldo Jimenez. Yeah.
High 6 ERA.
Yes. Well, look what happened today. You know, Gonzalez had a 4 ERA.
Kevin Guzman is 7-10 with a 3.58 ERA.
That's average.
He's legitimately probably their number one now that Tillman's gone.
Mm-hmm. So this is a team that obviously is heading into, they're in that division race in the East. Obviously, it's very, very tight. You know, you got Baltimore, or you got Boston, you got Toronto as well. I think Toronto will ultimately win that. They've been on top. Boston, I feel like Boston and Baltimore could get the final two wild card positions if it's not the Tigers. But Baltimore will have to really worry about their starting rotation. Yeah. They have a very, very depleted rotation with Tillman now out. So, you technically got like four fourth starters on your team, or third starters, you know. So we should be able to hit off these guys. We should not make Baltimore. We should not make Baltimore make these guys look like superstars.
But Baltimore also has a very potent lineup. That thankfully the Tigers have some good.
Their lineup is very, very comparable to Detroit's. They don't have the 20 home runs like, you know, Detroit has. They have five guys with 20 more home runs. I feel like our offense is slightly better if we're not in a funk, but time will tell, and we'll have to see how we actually perform. On paper, we should take this series 2 out of 3, but I don't know. It's the Tigers. So go Tigers this weekend and hope for best things. I'll say 2 out of 3. What are you going to go with?
2 of 3.
Let's hope so.
Hoping.
So this past weekend, football is back, and it's it was very loud and proud for U of M as they were able to take out Hawaii 63-3.
Oh, that was a great
game. It was a snooze fest probably after the first quarter. It was just total domination.
It was over after the first quarter.
And it's going to pretty much stay that way this weekend because they're facing a UCF team.
Are they favored by like 50?
Well, they...
What is the line right now?
The line is actually plus 21 Michigan. So,
that's it?
Yeah.
It'll go up to at least 40 by kickoff.
Well, I said it would be I'm going to go 42-13 Michigan in this one. I feel like the offense will cool off a little bit. I don't think we're going to shut down the Knights. This was a team that went 0-12 last year, and they actually started off this year on a very promising note. They actually beat South Carolina State 38-0 last weekend. So they're off to a 1-0 start, but you got to remember they're a Division I team. So.
Mm-hmm.
But Michigan, though, I mean, they moved up also two spots in the AP rankings. They went from 7th to 5th. Michigan State had a little bit of a scare, a big-time scare. Yeah. They could have definitely lost that opening game. But a lot of knockoffs this weekend. We saw LSU lose. Mm-hmm. Big victory for Wisconsin. They jumped up from being non-ranked.
LSU, I believe they beat.
Yeah, not ranked to go all the way up to like number 11. Unbelievable. And then Texas, huge victory for Texas. Texas football's back, everybody. But
Longhorns.
Yeah, I'm looking forward though. I mean, Michigan this year, we've talked about this, is that a couple shows ago when we were going down their line about the only team that they really have to worry about in the schedule is Ohio State. They are very, very, very favorable schedule. I mean, you got UCF this week, then you got Colorado, then you got Penn State. Remember we said five straight games at the Big House.
Mm-hmm.
Then it's good for us.
But you're gonna
you should be able to start off the season 4-0 relatively easily against these four teams, and then you have Wisconsin, who obviously we'll see where they are by week five, but you know, that's gonna be their final game before they jump on the road to face Rutgers. But Wisconsin on October the 1st, that could be, I think, your first test of the season. Rutgers should
be a
win.
Depending on what Wisconsin team shows up.
And yeah, well, Wisconsin's riding high now. Yeah, after what happened with LSU, they're riding high. So we'll see what happens there. But, you know, Wisconsin, they got a pretty easy schedule right now. They got Akron, then they got Georgia State, and then they got the Spartans on the 24th. So they got Spartans and Wolverines back-to-back weeks.
Or they can hang out in Michigan.
Both on the road. So if they can pull off two road upsets against both in-state rivals.
Bold prediction, they're going to beat one of us.
I think they're going to beat State.
They're going to beat State or Michigan.
They're going to beat State and they're going to lose to us. I feel like we'll take care of the Badgers. But like I said though, then you got an off week on the 15th, and then you got the Illini, the Spartans. That's going to be tough because you're going to be at Spartan Stadium. But Michigan State has a lot of work to do after that scare that they had.
Yeah.
So Maryland, Iowa, Indiana, and then of course Ohio State, and then if you're lucky, the Big Ten championship game at Lucas Oil.
You're hoping.
So we'll see what happens, but I'm excited for Michigan football. If you're watching that game, it's obviously
growing.
Nice to see that. And the quarterback situation, though, I don't know, man. With Michigan, I really just don't know what they're gonna have this year, because they're kind of Sugar Shane Morris came in the second half. What was his name? What was that guy's name? The quarterback that played.
Unfortunately for me, I was working.
You weren't watching some of that, were you?
So I was not able to watch the game. And plus, it was on ESPN, so you couldn't even go in the break room and check it out. Because
they had the TV on?
Yeah, they have a TV in the break room. But there is no ESPN.
Really?
Yep, no cable in the
break room. Damn. That's interesting.
Oh, yeah, but there's other college football games on.
Wilton Spate was the guy that everybody was talking about. What a name. Could that be your next famous quarterback out of Michigan? Wilton Spate was his name.
Sounds like
it. But there's still a battle. You know, he's pretty much locked in, I think, after his first week performance as the starting Corby. Mm-hmm. But, you know, there's still a battle for that backup job. You know, of course, you got Morris. And then, of course, you got John O'Korn and Alex Melzone. They got all reps. They all played. Spate, O'Korn, Morris, and Melzone all got playing time. So
and they're going to be able to get some playing time with these blocks.
I feel like you got to give it to Morris. I feel like Morris is the better guy for the job. I mean, I know you're – just in
everybody's
case Spate goes down.
Spate.
Yeah, well, after that performance, yeah. I mean, his first throw of the game wasn't INT. It wasn't pretty, but he got it out of the way quickly, and everybody was, like, going crazy on Facebook.
Oh,
like,
I bet.
Oh, no, dude. Like, what a way to start the season with an INT. But mm-hmm. He settled in nicely and ended up throwing, I think, three touchdowns. So it's an early season.
It is.
You got to wait till like week four when we start getting to Big Ten conference play. When you can start talking about Michigan football. But I'm excited. You know, this is probably the most hype that there is. You know, since any kind of Michigan team's been put on the field. Last year was a good year for Harbaugh's first season, but
this year it's all or nothing.
You had a great recruiting class, and so you really got to start riding the tides high here. So. Let's see here. Is this Chad in the room here?
Yes, it is.
What's up, brother? Nice to have you back on
the
show.
How you doing?
It's been a while.
Yeah, it has. Thanks for having me on again.
As always.
Absolutely.
So moving forward from our football talk from Michigan, we're going to talk about our Detroit Lions opening up the season against the Indianapolis Colts at Lucas Oil Stadium.
I'm looking forward to tomorrow's game, Carolina and Denver, rematch of the Super Bowl.
Yes, sir.
8:30.
Get your fantasy teams, get your lineup set before that game's going. I drafted my had my draft last night, so I'm pretty excited for it. But the Lions and the Colts, there's a lot of opportunity, I feel like, for the Lions in this game. I feel like it's not going to be a blowout. They have the potential to win this game. But it all depends on, you know, Matthew Stafford. Is he going to get the butterflies out early? Is he going to get Marvin Jones? Who's going to be the star in this game, in your opinion, Chad?
I think it has to be number nine, Stafford. Both secondary is their best players out with injury. They got a couple other defensive players out that aren't going to be playing. So number nine's got to be able to leave it, get in the end zone. Our linemen are going to have to really block to get Abdullah in the end zone. Mm-hmm. But we got to score.
I feel like, you know, that's going to be the key, I think, scoring first in this game. I mean, it's not going to be a guaranteed W for you, but, I mean, to get all the cobwebs out and to score first, put your team on the board, to set that tone early, I feel like that's going to kind of carry you through the rest of the game.
Colts are three-point favorites, right?
Yeah, they got the three-point favorite, but, you know, it's not guaranteed. I mean, I feel like we're going to have our chances. I think we're going to keep it close. In the end, I'm going to go 27-23 Indianapolis.
Ooh.
I hate to start off the season on a down note, but I feel like we're gonna come up just short, just because we're on the road. I feel like we're gonna start off strong, and then I feel like we're gonna tear off to the end. So
I think the Lions will end up winning.
What are you going with?
I think it's gonna be a really low scoring game.
Hmm.
Like 17-7.
17-7? You feel like we're only gonna give them 7 points?
Wow,
Danny, that's being very, very.
I'm going bold.
Nice.
I'm being really nice.
You're
right
being
now.
Very nice. Chad, what do you think?
I'm trying to be bold here. There's never bold radio talk anymore.
These teams are so, like, they have almost the exact same issues as the other team. So I think it's going to be more of a high-scoring game. I'm going 34-28 Lions.
Wow.
So I'm the only one here.
I'm going low. I just think something's going to happen. It's going to be a really low.
There's been times where I've predicted high, and, you know, it's always been like either a low-scoring
game or
somewhere.
It'll be like a 48-50 final score or something.
Yeah,
bogus.
I don't think it's going to be that kind of a classic.
Jumbo.
But
then I'll look like a complete moron next week.
Oh,
but
boy.
It is what it is.
It is. What do you feel like is going to be the key, though, if the Lions win this game? Other than Matthew Stafford, though, I mean, you can't be going out there throwing grapefruits in the beginning of the game. You can't be trying to go for Marvin Jones and then you throw like 10 feet over his head, because we've seen this. But
that's Stafford.
And injuries are going to be a concern. You don't want to see Stafford go down in week one. That's going to be the key. But, I mean, improvements to the offensive line in the offseason. Oh, I know, Danny, you love that, because you can see it happening, Danny. You can see Stafford going down on the first snap.
Yeah, I can see him
twisting
getting
his
hurt
ankle
in warm-ups. Matthew Stafford, done for the season, injured toe.
But other than number nine being the obvious answer, I mean, if the Lions are going to win, it's going to be a high scoring game. What's going to be the key though to that? I mean, other than just Matthew Stafford throwing touchdowns, I mean, the offensive line we saw improve. We saw our secondary got a little bit improved too. But who's going to be the shining star other than Stafford in this game? Do you think?
That's Matthew Stafford.
Oh God.
Offensively, the Lions got to be able to get a running game going, but defensively we got to get pressure on Andrew Luck. He's not 100%. He's not fully healthy. We got to get him off his game and make him uncomfortable, because I think our defense is better than their defense. We got more individual superstars than the Indianapolis Colts have.
I feel like, you know, this is like the one season where like the Colts, like, yeah, Andrew Luck, he probably drafted pretty high as far as quarterbacks are concerned in fantasy drafts. Some people probably took him in the top 10. But
who'd you take for your starting quarterback there, Derek?
Carson Palmer. I took Carson Palmer because I wanted obviously Aaron Rodgers. I've gotten Aaron Rodgers out of 3 years, and I always tried to, but I had the seventh pick, and you know, sometimes you want to draft a quarterback first, but I decided against it, and I ended up getting, you know, the Carson Palmer, his stats for this coming year. I mean, obviously.
Who's your backup quarterback?
Tyrod Taylor.
Well, you're gonna suck.
Tyrod Taylor.
You're gonna suck.
Well, I mean, I haven't even set my lineup yet. I got to do that, you know, probably either tonight or tomorrow at work. But I do got AP. I got AP.
Is that your first overall pick?
All day.
Yeah, that was my first overall pick.
When he struggles,
I was surprised that I was able to get him seven.
Or he breaks his leg or something.
Yeah.
Crazy. You're in trouble.
Or gets a domestic violence, you know, lawsuit against him or something happens like that
or something. Unfortunately, I don't see you being a real threat this year.
I probably won't.
I haven't looked at your whole roster.
I sent it to Steve and Chris, but yeah, I didn't send you to my line. Did you do a fun draft at all?
I didn't do any fantasy football. I did so many fantasy baseball leagues that it's so hard to keep up with baseball leagues, and I'm debating about a hockey league. But with baseball, you got to really be on it constantly.
Yeah.
So it's difficult. With football, you can set your roster like Monday, and then you're good. With baseball, it's like a daily occurrence. You got to get the proper pitchers. You got to get who's starting. And there's so many injuries every other day
that's true.
Baseball is difficult. But football, I should get into football.
That's what I told you.
I like the pigskin pick'em things. Yeah. I like just picking a team to win, and then you just go on and go on, and that's how I've won in the past. I do like fantasy football. I won't say I don't, but it's just, I don't know, maybe I got myself too much into the fantasy baseball right now, so I don't want to put another.
I'm not quite in
Yahoo
full
fantasy
yeah.
on there.
Like I say this with every sport, when the season kind of turns into another season for sports, like when hockey ends, and then baseball usually starts after hockey ends. It's like I can't get into baseball mode until hockey is completely over. Same with football. I can't get into football until baseball season is completely over, or if the Tigers are completely out of playoff contention, which they're not. But I think by probably week 3 or 4, I'll probably be fully into football. Because they can overlap, especially if the Tigers make the playoffs. But real quick, to close out our line segment, I want to do a little thing here. I know that here at D&D Sports Chat, we don't really condone gambling. But in this little, I like to play this little over-under game because it's something that, you know, it's kind of fun because you kind of can make these predictions in week one and then look ahead towards the end of the season and say, hey, you know, were we right, wrong, whatever. But there's a few players on the Lions team that I want to do some over-unders in, and just to get you know, our input on it. So Matthew Stafford, total passing yards for the 2016 season, over or under 4,400?
Go ahead first, Chad, since you were the guest.
He's had 4,000-plus yards in his last, I think, 3 seasons. So
no Calvin Johnson this year.
With no Calvin Johnson.
I'm going to go under, but just under. Like I'm going to go like 4,200 probably, just because I think our offensive line will be able to create a better running game this year.
That's
so
what I
think we'll
feel
be
like.
Running it a little more.
I'm going to go under as well. I'm going to say probably like around the 41-50 range. I feel like it's probably going to be just under, not by much. But he'll have another 4,000-yard season.
I would under as well, but he'll have another good season, as you guys both spoke of. But with Calvin Johnson retiring, obviously Jones is going to be good. You're hoping Golden Tate is good as well, but a little short, so under.
Interceptions thrown by Stafford this year, over or under 13?
Chad?
I'm going to go under with that as well. I'm going to say probably just under, like 11 or 12.
I'm gonna go 11 as well. I don't have a ton of confidence in this one.
13 interceptions.
13 interceptions is your base point. Now, Stafford has thrown between
Twitter's more conservative offense than anything.
Just so you remember, Danny, you know, Stafford has thrown between 12 and 19 interceptions in each of his last 5 seasons. The only reason I'm saying under, I think, is probably because he threw just 2 interceptions in his last 8 games last year. So last year he definitely showed a little bit more consistency. And with more running, I feel like that's going to help too. So I'm going to go with 11.
I'm going over.
You're saying over. What are you going to give it?
I'm like 14, 15.
Calvin Johnson disaster.
All right, so we got Stafford out of the way. So now we're going to go to our this is our predicted leaded rusher, Amir Abdullah. Total rushing yards in 2016, over or under 700?
Over.
I think that's easy. I think we're all going to say that. I don't think the Lions are going to be very good at running the ball this year, but I think Abdullah is probably going to get a huge portion of the carries this year after playing second tier to Joik Bell. You know, he still managed, I think, 600 yards last year, Abdullah. So, I mean, definitely.
It was like 60.
Yeah. I'm thinking he'll probably hit 700 by like week 14 at least. So
that should be pretty relatively easy.
Injury prone or not, we'll see what happens to Abdullah. As far as total rushing and receiving touchdowns, over or under 5. This is rushing and receiving.
Abdullah?
Yeah, this is total.
I'm going to go over.
Yeah, I'm going to say over as well. I'm going to give him 8.
I'm going to go over 6 or 7.
I think that, you know, he tallied 3 touchdowns in his rookie year. 5 should be an easy benchmark, I feel like, for any second-year player, and with getting more time, too. I'm not saying he's going to have a breakout year this year, but if he doesn't hit at least 5 touchdowns between rushing and receiving, it's going to be probably a huge disappointment, in my opinion.
How many did he have last year? Was it 3?
Yes, 3 touchdowns.
Okay.
Yep. Okay. How about Theo Riddick? Total receptions this year, over or under 62.
Mm.
He had 80 last year. He had 80 receptions last year.
I'm going to say just over because we lost one of the best players. But I think all around we have a better receiving unit, more guys that we can rely on to catch the ball. So I'm going to go over, but I'm saying like 65, 67.
Yeah, but I mean, between Riddick and Tate and Jones, I feel like you got more room for just passing. You know, you got a lot more of a core, like you said, and I feel like...
And Anquan Boldin.
Yeah, and Anquan Boldin, too, is that kind of like, I don't know if you want to call him like that... what's the word? Like a guy is that you're not really going to use a lot. But yeah, exactly. I'm going to go over. I'm going to go 65 on this one. He'll be under from last year, but I feel like 62 is pretty low. So I feel like I mean, he's the only running back to match that total of 62 was Danny Woodhead. What happened last year? And for Riddick, I feel like this came out of nowhere. His previous season high was actually just 34 catches. So. Mm-hmm. It's something like 80 catches. It's definitely, I feel like, attainable, but I'm not going to go that high. I feel like
I'm
going to
go under, actually. I just think with Boldin, with Jones,
Tate,
Stafford has so many different weapons, and I think Stafford's going to target these bigger name players. I think he's going to target Boldin and
exactly
a little bit more than he would, so I'm going to say under.
Now start getting to the big boys, the actual receivers. Golden Tate, total receiving yards, over or under 1,000.
Over. Be our leading receiver.
He's definitely stepped up since, you know, with Calvin in those 2 years that he was dealing with
he's
injuries.
He's got to be the number one receiver this year with Johnson gone. Mm-hmm.
Are you going
to
go over?
I'm going to go over as well. If he's not the number one receiver for this team and if he doesn't put up big, big numbers this year, you can forget the Lions being competitive. But if him and Boldin perform and beat expectations, this team will be a little bit better than what we're all thinking.
I'm going to be different. I'm going to go slightly under. I'm going to go somewhere around like the 920, 930 range. I feel like a lot of people are pointing like us. I feel like a lot of people are pointing to Golden Tate as the player to step into the number one receiving role with Calvin gone. But I don't necessarily see it. I feel like that's going to be Marvin Jones' job. I really do. And I'm not saying Marvin Jones is going to be like a mirror image of Calvin, but with the Lions having they have a plethora of receiving options. I feel like Tate will be a small sample in that, but he's definitely going to put a big hand in that, though. I say, 900 plus yards for him, but just under 1,000. Now, how about receiving touchdowns? Over or under 5?
Tate?
Yes.
Touchdowns
are a lot harder to predict than receiving yards.
Just based on the receiver is, because even if, like, you could be right and he could get 920 yards, but I bet he leads the team in receptions if he doesn't lead the team in yards, just because that's the type of player he is. You get him the ball short and let him do what he does in space.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is where
Chung plays, giving him more yards but less receptions. I'm going to say Tate is at 5 touchdowns.
So you're going to say you're going to stay pat at 5. Okay.
I'm going to stay pat at 5.
Danny?
I'm going to go a little over and say 6 or 7.
I'm thinking that I'm going to go with 7, and the only reason why is I feel like Marvin Jones is going to be the guy for the deep passes. I feel like Golden Tate's going to be the guy that you rely on more in the red zone, and we've seen this happen with running too. I mean, if Matthew Stafford somehow is able to improve his red zone game, then I feel like Golden Tate's going to be a receiver. I feel like he can jump a little bit higher than a guy like Marvin Jones. And he could also be your scapegoat too. He can be that guy that you just
Stafford still. Yes, you lose your big weapon with Megatron, but you also gain. You have 3 good weapons.
I see Tate as a decoy. I see Tate's gonna be that decoy that you're gonna use more often in the red zone.
He's a decoy, but yet he's your number one receiver.
Not necessarily number. I didn't say. I said that Marvin Jones will be your number one receiver. I said Golden Tate will be your guy in the red zone. You're gonna use more than Tate or more than Jones. I'm sorry, but I'm gonna go with 7 for Tate. I'm gonna go slightly over and say 7.
Okay.
Now we get to Marvin Jones, the new star of the Lions team, the replacement for Calvin Johnson. Total receiving yards, over or under 850.
Oh, over. I think he is 1,000.
Yes, I'm gonna say that's way over. I think
if he stays
will.
Healthy.
Yeah, if he stays healthy, he will lead this team in receiving yards all season long. He'll probably be at 800 by week 13 or 14. I think there's gonna be plenty of yards to go around. I feel like he's the outside deep threat that fits so well with the Matthew Stafford's, his arm. And we saw that in the preseason. If you paid attention to some of the preseason games, you know, guys like Tate and Anquan Boldin, and then you got Eric Ebron, they'll be great to, you know, dink and dunk their way down the field, as you can say.
Can you repeat that, please?
Dink and dunk, I guess you could say, is like the way the dink and dunk.
Oh, my Atlanta.
So I feel like, yeah,
Jones. That is audio deliciousness right there.
Jones is going to be that. He's going to be that deep threat, and I feel like that's where he's going to make a boatload of his yards. So I'm going to go way over 850. Danny?
I can't even focus right now.
Dink and dunk. I wish we could just get a sound bite. Dink and dunk.
We're going to clip that. That is a great bite. I got to go over.
Yeah.
He'll be the leading. I can't get over Deacon Dunk.
Well, wait. Didn't you say Golden Tate was going to be our leading receiver?
No, I said he'd probably lead the team in reception.
Okay.
I think Jones will lead the team in yards.
Okay.
Just because of the kind of receivers they are. I think Jones will get bigger chunk plays, but Tate's going to get a lot of underneath catches because he can make people miss very easily. Mm-hmm.
But can he deke and dunk?
Deke and dunk. Is he going to do it?
He's going to dunk and deke is what he's going to do.
All right. Final stat on Marvin Jones. Total receiving yards is where it's going to matter. Over or under, we're going to give you two, just like we did with Tate, five. Over or under five.
I'm going over with this guy. I'd say seven probably for Jones.
Goodness. If you can't tell, I'm already high on Marvin Jones. I said he's going to be our leading receiver. I'm going to go. I'm going to go with 11. I'm going to say Marvin Jones catches 11. 11.
Eric loves Marvin Jones.
Yes, I am definitely drinking the Marvin Jones Kool-Aid. I mean, he did catch. He caught 10 touchdowns in 2013 behind AJ Green, and I feel like he can put up similar numbers like that in Detroit.
You're loving if, him, aren't you?
We're going to find out.
Don't forget he's wearing Roy Williams.
Right. We're going to find out real quick, I'd say, by like week three or four if Marvin Jones is
real. I would say over, but
deal.
Not. I'm not going to go as high as you are.
I'm going to go 11, and you're going to go with?
Like 7 or 8.
All right.
I'm 7.
Okay. And then we're going to go with the last stat. And the only guy on defense that I'm going to throw in here is Zeke Ansah. Total sacks in 2016, over under 10.
Over. I think he's going to hit 17.
Yeah, I feel like he's going to be our leader on this team on defense.
I think he's going to be even better than last year. He's going to terrorize tackles in this league. He's so athletic.
I'm going to go over as well. I'm going to say like 16, 17.
I'm going to go over. I'm going to say around 15, 16. I think that I think teams are going to be heavily focusing on this guy because of how dangerous he was. He was a huge threat. I feel like defenses would rather take their chances with a guy like Devin Taylor, who's been plunged into kind of like a starting role for the first time in his career. So I feel like Ants is going to be that guy that you're going to miss. I feel like he's just going to completely sideswipe you.
I don't think teams are going to miss him. I think he's going to face
He will. Oh, he will. He'll dink and dive or dink and dunk. Oh yeah, he'll get to the quarterback. He's gonna get rid of all them offensive linemen. Just boom, bulldoze right through him. So I have definitely high praises for Zeke Ansah this year. So our final predictions.
You guys
then.
Have any bold predictions for anyone on the Lions?
As far as who's gonna have a breakout year or like just overall
anything.
Record.
Just any.
Oh, I'm going to go with Marvin Jones. I mean, honestly, it's not really a breakout year because he's a proven receiver, but I feel like he's going to step in and he's going to take, you know, Calvin Johnson's shoes. I'm not going to say he's going to step right into him and run with him, but I feel like he's going to be a very, very good, you know, secondary to Calvin. I feel like he's going to come in here, you know, receive 1,000 yards, 10, 11 touchdowns. I feel like it's going to be a very big impact for him this year. So I think Marvin Jones, barring any injuries, will be my key player this year.
That's the biggest concern for the Lions, I think, is injuries.
Always, yeah.
I got one for each side of the ball. Right. Defensively, I think DeAndre Levy is going to come back after a year off of injury and lead the league in tackles.
Whoa. Well, you saw what he did the year before he got injured.
Yeah, he almost did. He finished second.
Yes.
And then my offensive one, I think they said they're going to try and make Ebron the main red zone target, but I think Anquan Boldin's going to do it at the age of 36, and I think he's going to have 12 receiving touchdowns.
Wow.
Only have like 600 yards or something.
Holy
cow. I think he's going to have 12 touchdowns.
So are you saying that they're going to use Anquan Boldin more in the red zone? If he's only going to receive 600 but get 12 touchdowns, are you seeing him used more in a red zone capacity?
He'll be out there, but he's a big body guy.
Is he's more of a decoy?
He's one of the best receivers in the league, and even at the age of 36, a red zone target, he's so much bigger than most of the corners.
Oh, he's a tough
somebody.
Yeah, he is.
Stafford, if we know one thing Stafford can do well, it's throw a freaking fade route. So I think Anquan Boldin is going to develop and into one of our best red zone threats.
So you're saying that Boldin and Stafford is going to be a that's going to be a match made in heaven?
Inside the 15-yard line, I think so.
I think this could be the team to rejuvenate a guy like him. I mean, obviously, we've seen what he's been able to do
he's
in the past.
He's my concern going into the season, to be honest.
He's had health issues, and it's going to be a cause for concern.
But he's 36 years old, so.
Anytime. I mean,
he is usually,
as a receiver, you usually retire around that 35, 36-year mark. I mean, receivers only last about 10 years in this league nowadays.
Shoot, if that.
So, I mean, a guy like Boldin, you really got to take with some care. I mean, you got to really protect him, and you cannot let him take full-on hits. I mean, he can't be getting speared 5 yards in a route. So, I'm going to say Boldin. I'm not going to go quite that deep. I'm going to say Boldin gets probably around 7 or 8, but I think that he'll definitely be a threat. I think he'll be a great fourth receiver on this team.
From the way we're talking about this team, it sounds like they're a playoff-bound team, and we're predicting them to be.
Well,
we've
totally ignored the defense on this side. We've totally ignored the fact.
So where's the Achilles heel? Why is this team going to be so bad? Because we're talking very highly.
First of all, we haven't given our predictions yet. Let's give our final predictions on the 2016 season, and then we'll talk about why we think that they're going to finish either as bad or as good as we think they are. So, Chad, we'll go with you first. What's the final record for this Lions team?
I've been debating between 7 wins and 9 wins. For now, since I have not seen them play a full regular season game, I'm going to settle at 8-8 just based on their strength of schedule being 29th out of 32.
Yeah, it's a very favorable schedule.
I don't know. You'll get Lions games where they should win and they won't, but they'll come out and beat someone that they shouldn't. I mean, I think they'll start the season 2-0, but I still think they'll finish 8-8. Like I said, there's some fluctuation in there based on maybe what we see, but there's so many question marks. Like I said, we got some really good players on defense, but we also have a couple big holes. Strong safety, left outside linebacker, the corner opposite of Darius Slay, and then our second D tackle next to Elodie Nada. We don't know what we have in some positions, so. And our offensive line, we really don't know what we have there. So I'm going to go 8-8 just based on strength of schedule.
I feel like, you know, that's the same way. I mean, there's been times we saw a few years ago this team started out, 5-0, and we finished, 6-10?
Yeah.
Big time. So, I mean,
I think the Lions need to start out good, but they need to make
I don't
sure
even think, yeah. I don't feel like you're going to even find out the real Lions team until, around week 6 or 7, because I feel like you got to.
And you might not.
Yeah, because you got to get through. I mean, the Colts is going to be a tough task. The Titans should be a victory. The Packers at Lambeau. I don't know about that one. The Bears at Soldier Field, you should be able to beat them
it's
on
a
the
tough
road.
Place
the,
to
yeah,
play.
The Bears.
We beat them 6 times in a row.
Yeah.
We better beat them.
The Bears, I'm not too afraid of. The Eagles are beatable. The Rams are beatable.
Especially with Carson Wentz.
Yeah. You know, and the Redskins could be iffy. Then you got the Texans. Are we going to finally win on Thanksgiving this year against the Vikings? We play the Vikings 2 out of 3 weeks, for crying out loud.
Yeah,
I think we will.
I don't know. We've won 4 or 5 in a row on Thanksgiving now, but I mean, I think we can beat the Vikings at home. I don't think Sam Bradford's that good.
Sam, they were all in for that, giving a first round pick for Sam Bradford. And you know,
that's even thinking Sam Bradford will be healthy then. When does Sam Bradford stay healthy?
That's exactly the thing. I feel like what they gave up to get he's a Glassford. He's another Glassford. And this is a guy that you have just got to be tiptoeing around because everything is just give AP the ball. Give AP the ball. Do not let Sam Bradford get touched. And that's going to be it.
What you're hoping for.
I feel like this is going to be a record breaking year for AP. If you're Sam Bradford, because he's probably going to have a career high in carries this year.
Well, don't worry. If Bradford gets hurt, you can always call Tim Tebow.
Yeah. Oh, he's already in baseball mode.
Oh, yeah, he's trying.
But looking at the schedule, God, it's such a favorable schedule to us, but I'm going to go 7-9.
The Lions will be Lions.
Yes. That's why I can't. Exactly. I got to just laugh my ass off at the people that were calling into the ticket and saying this team's going to go 13-3, 12-4. When have we ever given that kind of.
I'll tell you what. Even with our schedule, we won't be over 10 wins. 10 wins will be the max we get.
That's over.
And the only reason our playoff hopes are alive right now are because the Vikings lost their quarterback and are going to be a hot mess on offense.
We should be able to beat the Vikings both games. We should. We should be able to.
We should sweep the Bears and the Vikings. And I'm not saying we're going to beat Green Bay either time, but we should definitely give them a run for their money at home. Especially
we're actually not facing Green Bay twice this year.
Underwater.
Did you know that we're not facing Green Bay? Or are we? One, two, three, four, five, six.
We play them week three and week 17.
That's right. For whatever reason, the schedule that I was looking at.
We were at Green Bay.
I was looking at the schedule, and it was only going to December 4th. I'm like, wait a minute, we don't play Green Bay a second time. That's impossible. But this schedule only went to the 4th. But look at the schedule, though. I mean, I can pinpoint games that we should win. I mean, the games that we should win, I'd say this team could go definitely 9-7. If you know, but I feel like they're going to lose about two or three games that they should win, and they're not. But I'm going 7-9. I think the Packers are going to dominate the North again. I feel like the Packers are probably going to go 12-4.
13-3 this year.
12-4, 13-3 are the Packers, and I feel like second will probably be, as much as you don't want to say it, Minnesota. But I feel like
I think Detroit will be second. I think Minnesota and Chicago will be like 5-11, 6-10.
I'm going to go. I think the Vikings are going to finish second. I feel like the Vikings are probably going to go 9-7, and I think we're going to go 7-9, and then the Bears are going to go like 4-12.
My Bears are Lions 6-10. I know it might be a little bit much, but
6-10, huh?
6-10.
Wow. So you're giving no hope at all.
No.
No love.
I can't jump on this Lions team right now. I just can't do it.
We don't want you anyway, Dan.
Ooh, ouch.
As much as I would love for this team to be successful, because God knows we need a successful.
Well, Dan and I are the most non-knowledgeable about football. So
I'm knowledgeable. I've done my homework, and I've done some research.
I know, but
research,
comparing to hockey and baseball, we're not up to par with like a guy like Chad. That's why we bring Chad in for a football talk. So, you know, hearing some of his insight and then reading some of it from what the pros are stating here on Twitter and on Google and stuff, it's like – you know, a lot of people
don't
have been saying.
Don't agree with everybody says.
Everybody thinks
they're experts, but they're not.
I still feel like you can say baseball is unpredictable, but I feel like football is probably the most unpredictable sport because it's the shortest season, and it's only 16 weeks, and you really reap what you sow.
One big injury,
no,
and there goes
no
your
room
role.
For error.
No, yeah, no room for error. I mean, if you lose a top tier player,
start off bad and rebound.
No,
ten in these other leagues.
Yeah, normally an injury in football, very, very rarely will you come back for the season. I mean, usually these injuries are season ending. You see a lot of ACL tears and, you know, a lot of groin tears and just a lot of things that you just do not want to see, and they're usually season ending injuries. And so we saw it happen, Teddy Bridgewater. Obviously, that was a gruesome injury, and, you know, his career could be over. So I hope that's not the case, but, you know, God bless the Vikings, I guess. What do you guys think for the new L.A. Rams? What do you think they're going to do this year? Even though it's pretty much the same team from before, just relocated. But, you know, for that team return to L.A., what do you think they're going to do? I think they're going to go 9-7.
That good?
I'm going to go a fluky 9-7. They should go like 6-10, but I'm going to go 9-7. I feel like they're going to have a fluky season.
Scaring me.
Sounds like Justin.
I don't know. Jared Goff's going to be inactive week one, so he's obviously not ready. Case Keenum's not good. I mean, Todd Gurley's good. They don't really have a receiving game. Their front seven's good on defense. Their secondary's not great. And they happen to be in the best division of football. I'm going third in that division, and they're going to go 6-10.
Okay.
6-7.
You can say that, like, wait, for instance, 7-9 is usually not much different from 9-7. It's just a complete flip-flop. I mean, it's two games, but that could be the difference between a non-playoff berth and, let's say, a wild card. But
they are in a really, really tough
the
division.
Tigers are, the Tigers.
Seattle and Arizona own that division. San Francisco and Los Angeles won't be close.
The Lions, to even have a chance at a wild card, would have to win 10 games. As competitive as the NFC is, I feel like 10 wins will probably get you the wild card spot, and it's just not going to happen this year. If it happens, it's going to be – it's going to – if the Lions were to go 10-6 this year, would you be shocked?
Yes.
10-6? Yeah. Look at 2011. Do we ever think we were going to go 10-6 in 2011? No. 2014, did we ever think we were going to go 11-5?
No. This is Jim Caldwell's final season.
This is his final season to prove that last year was a fluke. I won't say this. I will not say if we miss the playoffs, whether it be 6-10, 7-9, 8-8, whatever the case may be, I don't think Jim Caldwell will get fired. I mean, we saw how long Jim Schwartz lasted. He went six seasons. And he had four losing
Jim
seasons.
Jim Schwartz is a little different, though, compared to Jim Caldwell.
What do you think?
Jim Schwartz took over an 0-16 team, so he had a lot of leeway to get that team
That's
off.
True.
He did, and then he fell off at the end. Caldwell came into a win-now situation.
He's on a short leash.
He had a good year and a bad year, so.
I feel like this is his redemption year.
I don't like Caldwell. I don't care for him, so if he gets canned, I'm not going to be upset about it. But I guess we'll have to start the season with, like, two wins and six losses for him to get canned at the bye week.
Yeah.
I don't see him getting canned in season.
It's gonna take a lot. I feel like we'd really have to fall apart completely. I mean, this team would totally have to underperform if that's the case. If we start off the season 2-6, which I don't see happening, or 0-5, good God! I mean, I don't see that being the case. But no, it is the Lions, so nothing can surprise you there. But I won't be surprised. I'm gonna be one of those people. Like, if we were to finish the season at 10-6, I wouldn't be surprised, only because it's like
you're going to get that Jones jersey at Kmart, aren't you?
Not gonna go that far, but I'm just saying is that. That just meant that we played to our potential. I feel like we played to our potential. If we go 7-9 or 8-8, we didn't play to our potential. Then we reap what we sow. But if we finish 10-6, then it's kind of a surprise, and we played to our potential. So I'm going 7-9. Dan, you're going 6-10. Mm-hmm. Chad, you're going 8-8. So we'll see what happens. We're all very, very close to each other. That's for sure. Go Lions. To wrap up the show, we just had some quick WWE news.
I got a little something else.
Wait, before we do that, Danny, go ahead.
So, has anybody watched Stranger Things?
I did, yes.
No.
So, is there any hype for this, or is this just all me? I've heard that good things about Stranger Things, and I started watching it.
Did you not finish it?
And I did okay. Complete it all. Yeah. I thought it was very different, and I was thinking all along that it was going to be a little bit different, and it was going to be actually scary, and I was actually a little bit disappointed with it.
Really? I mean, I wasn't blown. I mean, it's not like a Walking Dead for me, but I mean, it's a good short little season. Winona Ryder, obviously, you know, very, very great actress. I feel like she fit her role good. I'm not going to give away any spoilers for people that haven't watched it yet, but I mean, I thought it was going to be more of like an American Horror Story, like anthology, like where every episode was a different story, but I mean, it does stay on the same exact story and storylines, but. I wasn't like blown away by it or anything, but I mean, I liked it. I thought it was a very, very enjoyable series, and I wasn't scared by any means. It was more mystery and suspense. It was more suspenseful, but I enjoyed it, so I'll leave it at that.
I'll watch it again. I'll watch season two. When it does come back, but it needs a little bit more for me. A few of the episodes had me where I was like, okay, this is cool. And then other episodes, I'm shaking my head and I'm like, what did I just watch? I just wasted an hour and 5 minutes of my life watching this garbage. Like, it's very inconsistent.
Is that on TV or Netflix?
Netflix,
yeah.
Okay. I don't watch it, but I heard the comparison I've gotten from a couple of people, it's like the X-Files almost.
A little bit, yep. I haven't seen the series, but Netflix has really been known to have some great original series as of late.
Daredevil's phenomenal.
Yeah. Has anybody seen Narcos?
I heard of it.
But I've heard good things about it.
Yeah, my brother's been like just raving about this, and obviously it's about a drug cartel. And,
obviously.
You know, so it's all, you know, one season. It was actually two seasons. I take that back. Two 10 episode seasons. And it's getting a lot of high praise on Netflix. My brother was like just saying, he's like, yeah, I just been watched the entire series like in 2 days. And I was like, damn, well, I haven't watched it yet. So, but yeah, a lot of good series. Mm-hmm. You know, House of Cards is, you know, that ran away with a lot of awards. And, you know, yeah, Danny, you watched Daredevil. And so, I mean, yeah, Netflix is definitely.
Jessica Jones.
Yeah, it might not have the greatest movies, and it might condone a lot of teen pregnancy or preteen pregnancy with the selection of movies it has. But it does have a lot of damn good series on there. So.
Orange is the New Black.
Orange is the New Black, of course. That was one of the original ones. So, but yeah, so far Stranger Things has kind of like been my favorite of what I've watched from there. Oh, and Fuller House. Hey, Fuller House season 2 coming up soon.
Fuller House, shout out.
No, Olsen twins yet again.
Thank you.
Screw them. So
they've been blasting Olsen twins.
Oh yeah, I can't wait for more Olsen twin jokes in this season. I bet it's going to be even better. I'm ready. All right, so WWE news: Backlash this Sunday on the WWE Network. It's a SmackDown only. Yep, SmackDown only. So it's not going to be top tier performance as far as
only the
Raw
first people. Match or the last match matters.
Somehow. Yeah, exactly. Right. I mean, who really wants to see the
I
end
ask
of this?
You guys, like, do you watch both?
I have watched every.
I can't stomach watching a whole SmackDown.
But it's easier. I'm telling you right now, it's easier because it's only a 2-hour show. I feel like.
Good point.
Raw has the better storylines.
But less.
What's that, Chad?
But the talent is so much less than Raw.
Oh, it is. The talent is so much more like less prominent than Raw. Raw has the better storylines, but I feel like SmackDown puts a better product with what they have because it's only 2 hours. I feel like I'm not drained after watching SmackDown as I am with Raw.
Raw, you spent 3 hours of your life that you could be doing, and really, doing laundry or doing homework or doing something productive.
And I would say that probably a good portion of it is probably commercials and stupid promos. And Raw,
SmackDown has a lot of divas.
Sorry,
that's a sin now. But
now they have mostly all the divas or women's wrestlers, and they have now they have their own tag team championship.
But they don't have Nia Jax,
and they don't have the cruiserweight division. But I heard they're soon to get one. I hear that Vincent Mann wants to see how this cruiserweight division does on Raw for the first few weeks, and then if it takes off, they're going to put the they're going to put some on SmackDown.
Yeah, because I would love to see these cruiserweights against Braun Strowman. And
Brian Kendrick returning to the main
roster. Love to see Brian Kendrick versus Braun Strowman on Raw. Goodness.
But yeah, obviously, with Backlash coming up, the big match, AJ Styles versus Dean Ambrose, please let AJ Styles win the championship.
Mr. Phenomenal.
Oh, no, please not.
Wait, what? not an AJ Styles fan here, Chad?
I'm not an AJ Styles.
Uh-oh, Danny.
He's a good wrestler, but I'm not a fan.
Defend your boy.
Fair
here.
Enough. I do like AJ Styles. I think he's
way better as a heel.
Dean Ambrose. I ain't gonna lie to you. I like Dean Ambrose. That is hilarious.
All right, see, I like Ambrose, but I feel like his title run...
I act like Dean Ambrose at work.
I bet you do. I feel like his character has just been going kind of dry on me lately. I feel like they're just really force... I don't want to say they're force-feeding us Dean Ambrose like they were with Roman Reigns, but I'm just not been too happy about his title run. I feel like it's been kind of meaningless lately.
I think AJ Styles will win, though. I think he'll hold it for a couple months, and then I think Cena's going to come back, and I think then he'll beat AJ Styles and get it for the 16th time.
One last run?
I feel like if John Cena's going to win, he's going to tie Ric Flair, he's probably going to beat Styles. I feel
one
like
one last run for
that's
Cena?
What I'm saying.
Cena?
Think Styles will beat him. Or the Ambrose, he'll hold it for a month or two.
WrestleMania,
wherever he's at.
Oh no, he won't be at WrestleMania.
He'll take it and get it at 16.
John Cena, it's hard to believe this, but you know John Cena has not held a world title in 3 years. It's been 3 years.
I know, it's crazy.
I know. I just heard that stat the other day.
Ran the place.
Yeah, he's no longer the face that runs the place.
Face that runs the place.
That's AJ
Finn
Styles.
Balor.
No, that's AJ Styles.
Finn Balor.
He's What is, all right, so switching gears to SmackDown, since that's really the only match that matters at Backlash, switching gears from SmackDown to Raw, what are your thoughts on KO as the champion? Do you like that move?
I was kind of talking with Dan about it on Facebook, and I figured that was going to happen, either him or Rollins, because, yet again, it's always so predictable. Reigns gets screwed by somebody.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
so he's still got to eat some dog.
Dominating the match, and someone comes and screws them because they do that all the time. But I was a little shocked that Triple H did that. Mm-hmm. Seth Rollins.
That was an Attitude Era moment.
That was great.
That was really.
Yeah, that
I
was,
mean, I marked I'm out.
That
it.
Was best for business.
That was
say.
Best for business. I mean, I feel like that was the most talked about segment in years. That was something that you would see about 15 years ago in the Attitude Era. Triple H coming out, or whoever the case may be, you know, screwing whoever his boy was, or you know, whoever he had. I mean, really, as soon as he threw Kevin Owens back in that ring, I knew he was going to turn on Seth Rollins. I knew it. I was calling it out before it even happened. Danny was sitting right there. I knew something was going to happen. And when he pedigreed Rollins, I mean, but I feel like WWE, once again, they've done this with storylines. They dropped the ball, just as they did with The Miz and Daniel Bryan a couple weeks ago on SmackDown.
They had all that publicity, and
yes.
they absolutely just let
and
it
just
all
when
go
you thought,
straight to the toilet.
Yeah, and do Ziggler and Miz, like, we give a shit about that. And then this Monday on Raw, you don't even have Triple H show up. They dropped the ball.
But
that would
have
been
two
great.
Two hot things that you could take the ball and run with it a little bit, and you just completely kill off both of them.
I watch, you know, every now and then I watch Vince Russo's podcast. I know Vince Russo is a hot commodity, you know, in wrestling forums. People usually hate him. They talk shit about him. But he makes a lot of good points. And he doesn't, as much as people think that he hates Kevin Owens or he's bitter about WWE, you know, and stuff like this, he's not. If you listen to his podcast, he really tells you a lot about what he's thinking of the product. And he's right 9 out of 10 times, in my opinion, because they keep taking good storylines and they turn them into wrestling angles. Like, by not having Triple H on Raw, that was more of a wrestling angle, which is bad for business. They could have had him on there and made it personal. You know, I don't like how Seth Rollins comes out and does not cut a promo on Triple H, does not give us any hints that him and Triple H will be fighting in the future.
Maybe
instead,
they're setting it up.
They're saving
they're
it.
Setting
yeah.
it up.
Oh, yeah, they're saving it. But, I mean, throwing Roman Reigns, the only reason why Roman Reigns is being thrown into this world title pitcher is because Rusev's 23-day honeymoon right now. That's where he's at. He's banging Lana in Puerto Rico.
Do you think they'll make it a triple threat match?
No. Nope. I feel KO's going to win that match, and I feel like I've heard that Roman's going to feud with Chris Jericho. I think Chris Jericho is going to come down to the ring and interfere and cost Roman the match, and then we're going to see Roman versus Jericho.
Relevant. That's all I'm going to ask.
Why is he relevant?
Like, he's a great speaker.
He's entertaining as hell. He's
born in the ring.
I love Jericho.
You got to drink it in, man. The gift to Jericho.
Love Jericho.
He reinvents himself every couple of years, and I love it. You know, he comes back with the light up jacket. It gets destroyed by Dean Ambrose. So now what's he do? He wears a damn black scarf to the ring and puts his hand out like he's
very feminine.
Yeah, femininity. Walks to the ring. I love that heel Jericho walk. And
I walk around like that at work too.
Yeah, I mean you can just like walk around and just like smell the air and
twiddle your thumbs.
Yeah, all these peasants in here bow down to my feet. You know, I love Chris Jericho. I think Chris Jericho will never get stale to me because he constantly is reinventing himself. And Chris Jericho versus Roman Reigns, I think it'll make sense because Jericho and Owens obviously are BFFs right now. And
Jericho can really
have Roman Reigns beat Jericho. I mean, that'll probably make sense. And then you just kind of, you know, keep that thing going for a couple weeks until Rusev comes back. And then you have Roman win the United States Championship from Rusev and have him run with that for a while.
Something. He's one of the best wrestlers on the program and you screw him.
What's this? Roman Reigns. Are you a Roman fan, Chad?
I do like Roman.
Ooh. See, I can't. I want Roman to eat more shit. I'm not for Roman yet.
Why I like Roman is because when him and Seth Rollins had the long feud for a while, it's the point that Rollins always got help and Roman always got screwed, and that's why I've never really cared for Rollins. I think Rollins is really talented, but you're always getting helped out. Win it on your own for once, kind of like AJ Styles with Cena. Will AJ finally beat Cena on his own? But now I think I'm going to like Rollins more because he's going to be the one getting screwed. It's just the same storyline, different person.
So it sounds like you're more of like a guy that's a fan of faces than heels. You're not a big heel fan?
Nah, not really.
I'm not a big baby face guy. I mean, I like Finn Balor. But now with
of me, right?
You introduced me to Balor. I mean, I watched some of his NXT stuff before you even told me about it. I mean, I liked his look and his gimmick and his music, and it's a shame he went down with that injury. But with Finn being down, I feel like Seth Rollins will be the new the face of the company, and it's at least it's going to be an organic babyface turn. They're not going to force it. Obviously, they planted the seeds. I feel like on Raw. After the show was over, I guess he teamed up with, who did he team up with? Roman Reigns, I guess. And then Roman speared him. Yeah. Then Roman speared him, and basically said, I don't need your help. But Seth Rollins now getting screwed. I feel like that's going to be the key to making him a successful babyface. And then when Finn returns, he probably turns Seth heel again. So.
Possibly.
I like it. I feel like, but as far as backlash is concerned, I'm all for AJ Styles winning the belt.
A former WWE superstar. Big, UFC debut this weekend, this Saturday.
Yes, CM Punk, UFC 203.
Yeah, trying to cut weight. I know he's at like 200.
Dude, he was over 30 pounds.
He's not going to back out for another surgery before then?
Dude, he's going to have like half of his stomach taken out because I don't know how intense.
He's like 220, something like
that. In 10 days, he was 30 pounds over. He was over 200 pounds. He needs to cut down to 170 for the fight. He was at like 203. Unbelievable. How do you drop that much weight?
Sit in a sauna, I guess.
Dude, he's going to be so weak. He's going to come up with some excuse.
So frail.
Dude, 2 days before the fight, he's going to be able to barely stand up.
That's the thing is, he's going to get destroyed because he's just not nourished.
Yes.
He's not
very
eating.
Malnourished.
He's going to be exhausted because he's trying to cut so much weight. So he's going to get smoked. And then everybody's going to have an excuse for him because he's cutting so much weight.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't know, man. Like,
now,
we haven't
heard
much.
Now, if he doesn't lose any more weight, is that fight off?
Yes. He would have to find a new opponent in his weight class. I'm pretty sure, right, Jed?
I'm not sure.
I'm not positive.
Because they had to do that with, obviously with Jones and who was that guy that Jones was supposed to fight before he got suspended? Cormier?
Might have been.
Daniel Cormier? And they had to find a new opponent for Cormier when Jones got suspended. So I don't think that Punk would still fight, I'm pretty sure, but that fight with... what's his name? Mickey Gall, is that his name? I think that would be off, but he would have to find a new opponent in his
or
weight class.
Or Gall would have to accept it at Punk's weight that he
I don't think so, man. I think that you have to...
You have the option.
Is it? Under UFC regulations, you can still accept the fight if you're not in the weight class?
I didn't think they could.
I didn't think so either.
I thought you could...
I haven't heard much news on it lately, but I just heard... This was like just a few days ago that he was like 30 pounds overweight.
That's carelessness.
That's bullshit on Punk's part. That's carelessness and laziness to me.
Punk's been training really hard. I'm not going to dog
him. Then why are you putting weight on? I mean, that's just... I don't know how you can do that. It's not muscle. Can't be all muscle.
I don't know. He hasn't wrestled in a long time.
Well, when he wrestled, he was under 200 pounds. I'm pretty sure he was only like 160, 170.
I don't know how much he weighed when he wrestled, but he seemed like he maybe got a little bit heavier. I didn't know CM Punk's exact weight when he was wrestling, obviously, but I couldn't remember him being like 220, 230 pounds when he was wrestling, but I guess he packed on a few pounds.
Mm-hmm.
But he's
doesn't
been
show it. Yeah.
He's been training for so long that
He's been training for what, 2 years now?
I know he got hurt, so he probably sat at home and I don't know, did rehab and probably couldn't work out as much and train. But now that he's been training, it's surprising that he's not able to make his weight. So that's interesting. Hopefully that fight takes place. Is that this Saturday?
What is it, 10 o'clock? Yeah, I think it's around 10 o'clock. I know Steve and I were talking about going to B-Dubs to watch it for free. He was, because we were talking over a year ago about, like, you know, he was going to order it and we were going to chip in money and have a viewing party at his place. But then he flip flopped and said, well, we can just go to B-Dubs.
Look that up. I'm curious right now. Look it up. When does the UFC actually start? Not the prelims. The actual
prelims start like 6, I think.
But the UFC fights don't start until like 10:30, 11 o'clock because they don't get over until like 1 in the morning.
I know. Because I remember I got home late one night and there was a, the Brock Lesnar fight when Brock Lesnar fought and his fight didn't even go on until like 12:30. In the morning. So, let me see.
So, CM Punk's fight is probably not going to start until like 11:30, 12 o'clock. Because I'm sure he's going to be I'm sure he's going to be close to the main event.
UFC 12.
Because he's money for Dana White. Let's face the facts.
Start time. Let's see here. Because there's the Miocic and Overeem fight. I think that's the headlining fight. Let's see here.
It's in Cleveland. I know that much. It's not very far away.
The prelims, the main card, Mickey Gauver, CM Punk. Yeah, see that? Because they're all different weight classes. You got the 265, which is the heavyweights. That's the Miocic and Overeem fight. And then there's the Werdum and Travis Brown fight, Mickey Gauver, CM Punk. And then Jimmy Rivera versus Urijah Faber. It is.
That's
going to
be a good fight. Faber's the bomb.
What time is it on? Coverage on main event begins at midday on Sunday, September 11th. The Miocic versus Overeem main event will feature from 1:45 p.m. onwards, dependent on earlier times. 1:45?
What? P.M.?
What is this?
That doesn't make no sense.
No way.
Is it 1 p.m. or 8?
It said p.m., but what's like...
What?
I don't get that. Yeah, I don't get that.
The other ones around is in
what
the
coast?
The 11:45 that they missed.
Let me see this event schedule. Gosh, nobody has like a okay right here. Preliminary card starts at 8, and then the main card starts at 10. So you got two matches are before CM Punk versus Mickey Gall. They're in the middle, so I'm thinking Punk and Gall will probably be at midnight, and then the main event at 1. So it'll probably be getting done around 2 in the morning.
Yeah, right when B-Dubs is closing.
Mm-hmm. No, B-Dubs will be open for that. They'll stay open for the fight, yeah. But yeah, the main event, there's 5 matches on the main card that will begin at 10 o'clock. So.
See, I would like to be able to catch that.
Huh?
I'm working a little bit later. But
come to B-Dubs.
I would like to be able to catch that fight.
I'm sure I'm going to hear from Steve. I'm sure we'll be at B-Dubs Westland for that fight.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully they don't charge you a cover.
I don't know.
They just want you to drink their $10 beer.
Yeah, and eat their $20 wings.
Yeah, well. Other than that, guys, that's about all I got.
Yeah, that's I'm good.
Pretty good show. Went about an hour and a half here. And, Chad, thanks again for coming on. Hopefully you can kind of be on a weekly basis to kind of give your insight on the Lions as their season kicks off.
Yeah, my schedule should be a lot clearer than it was the last month and a half. So
awesome.
I should be able to.
Sweet. And, Danny, just make sure
right,
you don't be working.
Thanks for having
me, guys. Awesome. All right, we'll catch you next week, man. Take care.
All right, have a good one.
And with that being said, we're going to call this one a podcast, man. So on behalf of myself, Danny, and Chad, we will bid you guys a farewell. Catch you next week.
Adieu.